Ford is coming out with an all-electric compact SUV under the Mustang brand named Mach-E. I did a first impressions from the unveiling you can check out in case you missed it, but recently at CES, I was able to sit down with their global director of product development for battery electric vehicles, Darren Palmer, and dive a bit deeper into what they're up to and how the Mach-E came to be. Let's free the data. First, I really wanted to hear about their overall strategy and what Ford is up to when it comes to electrification.
We're committing in a big way to electrification.
Yes.
And we changed our strategy, or really, we started our main strategy a couple of years ago. The board and the CEO decided that the technology was reaching the point where we are going to be able to bring fantastic products at the kind of prices that are affordable for customers. And so they formed Team Edison, whose job was like a startup, a cross-functional group of all ages, male, female, different backgrounds, come together to decide where shall we play, what's important, and what's the future for electrification for Ford, where to play and how to win. And that team's first output was that in order to advance the take-up of electric cars, you need to make them aspirational. Make them something people never had before, and then their desire to have it will pull. And so we decided this is the way we're going to go. And then we decided, focus on the kind of segments of cars that have been successful for Ford that people love. And the first one is the SUV, the small SUV. And then we moved to commercials, which is very important, different attributes for commercials. And then the F-150, of course, we've announced as well. So focus on the things that we know people love and then bring them into the electrified world. But don't expect them to move just because it's electric. It has to offer something they never had before. So that's a strategy change for us in the last couple of years. This is the first car of the work that we've been doing.
So it seems like they're all in, but I specifically wanted to know about the goals for the Mach-E.
This is the first ground up BEV we've ever built.
Right.
And that's what makes the difference.
Yeah.
Because it's really that hard. That's why there's not many cars that do that kind of mileage. It's really difficult.
Yeah.
And you have to start from the battery and build up the car around the battery. It's the only way.
Yeah.
So that's what we did, and we set our sights on over 300 miles to begin with, because that's what customers said. They have range anxiety, and if it starts with 100 and 200, 300 is when they start to feel more comfortable.
Right.
And so that's why we set that as an objective and a goal. When we started thinking, what type of car should it be? And it was an SUV, so which brand shall we lean towards? Well, Mustang's the best-selling sports coupe in the world, and it has so much emotion. Really true to Ford, it's really one of our beloved cars. So could we make an electric car ties into Mustang and moves very much into the future? That's how we started.
Now, before we got too far into the conversation and the weeds here, I wanted to ask about probably the most controversial choice that they made, which was to use the Mustang brand for an SUV.
So that was a huge, huge decision. I mean, the car is one of the few cars in the world that lasted five decades and is still at the top of the charts, is still loved. Everybody's got a Mustang story and they're beloved. So to touch that name, we take very seriously. Of course, the people that did that are in our company and they were part of this team too. Because as soon as we knew it's Mustang's inspired with it, we brought those people in and said, what would that need to be to make it authentically Mustang? Now, we started off inspired, but as the project developed and we saw what it could be and what it could do, we at first we weren't sure about the idea, and then it started to grow on us as we thought, but I would love a car that I can get the whole family in, that I can use all year, that has all that connectivity and that performance and handling. Why wouldn't that be a new generation Mustang? Because that's what we would want. I still have a Mustang Coupe. I have one. I love it, and that's, I'm always going to love that. But this is additional. Now I can drive a Mustang every day with my family in it as well. So that's what started to grow on us, and we thought, wow, what could that be? But it has to be authentic. So we did the performance. It really has great performance. The handling, it has outstanding handling, low center of gravity. It feels like a Mustang. And then we had all the little touches and the emotion. With little touches like, it's got little cues from Mustang, like ground speed on the screen, which a Mustang owner would know, but others wouldn't. It has hints to the styling. It projects the Mustangs on the road when you walk up to the vehicle. And it has its own authentic sound.
Yeah.
Because it's Mustang, it has to have emotion to it.
Wait, the sound it will make? What's he talking about?
As we lean further into it's a Mustang, every department who also did work on Mustang, we rent to them. What about the door handles? What about the lights? What about the, what would Mustang be? And then they helped us, and all hundreds of people. And one area we said, what about the sound? I mean, what would Mustang be? So a department who does all of sounds in the company said, let us look at that. Started a whole project, what should it be? And we started off in the early days. You know, we had, at one time we had, we were listening to Vols, we had Batman, right? And we had sci-fi films and what's the film, just rebooted recently. We were, what is that sound? What, they were explaining technically what the sounds were. Yeah. That's what they were. So, okay, got it. And Jetsons and all different, and then V8 Mustang, all that stuff. And we were like trying to make sense of it. What would it be? What, and it came out straight away, and we spoke to customers very quickly. Yeah. First thing came out every time, first thing, authentic. Yeah. Whatever you do, authentic. Yeah. I don't want fake stuff. I want authenticity. So we started recording the motors and the drive systems and what type of sounds they make, and started to work from there. And then we enhanced the natural sound of the vehicle. And it's very complex, multi-timbral. It changes not just pitch or volume, it changes completely throughout the range. And it's a unique sound. And then we used some new tools. We've got VR tools with sound where we would drive the car past a cafe and we would sit you in the car. We'd have you stood at a crossing and the car would pull up and then pull away to see what it would sound like. And then you, because the sound goes with the shape of the car, it goes with the car. And so it's part of it. And so now it has its own unique sound. And the exterior sounder, there's a legal requirement.
Right.
And we have to make the legal sound. But we overlaid the legal sound with the authentic Mustang sound, which is the same one as inside, which is louder. So all you hear is the new authentic Mustang sound. And there was a moment in LA when we unveiled, it was dusk. And there were three cars coming in from the run with the journalists. And they pulled it 1, 2, 3, and they went kind of zoo, zoo, zoo. I was like, oh, and I looked at my friend, like, oh, that sounds so good, right? I was like, wow, that was a moment we had after developing and expected that, but that unique sound, right, something that you'll, it's part of the emotion of the car.
Now that all sounds good, but I really wanted to press them a bit and talk more about how many of the Mach-E they plan to make.
So here, this ties to something really important, okay? So there have been electric cars that just lose lots of money. The car makers make them for compliance. We said, that's not sustainable for anybody. And we, all companies, are motivated to sell more things that make money. So one of the goals for the car is to be positive margin, which means the cost is less than the price we sell it. That means you want to sell more. So this car is.
Yeah.
And we did that with a combination of our fantastic purchasing team who got the price of the batteries that we share with many other cars. We got them low. And it also means just the right type of volume and price. So we've set a price that's very reasonable, but and our initial ambitions are 50,000 for the first year. Now, many people think that's low, but we want to start there, see how people take up, see how they enjoy it, and then we can go from there. So that's, we've already said that's our first year, and actually we already sold out of the launch edition vehicle.
Okay, so 50,000 in the first year isn't nothing. That's a decent amount, but where are they going to make it?
It's a complete refit of a factory with its own line, because it's kind of quite efficient in some ways making electric cars, and we bring the battery assembly in-house. Instead of making engines in-house, we now make battery assembly, cells you buy elsewhere. And so that makes it efficient, again, to give the price point. So really, with incentive, the price point in this car starts at $35,000 for an SUV.
All right, so they have a plant that's being retrofit. Makes sense, they're a big company, they have lots of factories, et cetera. But what is their go-to-market strategy? How are they actually going to roll this out? Because that can be a make-or-break thing for an EV. Think Nissan Leaf and Chevy Bolt.
So you got to start with ones where you can make them aspirational and you can make them what a customer wants them to be. Hence this one, very reasonable price and lots of content for the vehicle. So the next cars we'll do, we said Transit, F-150, and then other cars, we're leaning into cars that people want. And cars that people are very, SUVs are very popular and keep growing and growing and growing. So that's what customers are pulling. So we're going to lean into products that customers are pulling. They also happen to be the ones that can be higher end and you can put some really amazing content into. So using this platform, we can move more into those type of vehicles. I think that's what people want at the moment.
But what about Lincoln? That's their higher end brand. Are they planning anything in that space for a battery electric vehicle?
It's very important for Lincoln because in the luxury space, it's really affected by electrification. We see customers wanting more electrification. So we just launched the plug-in hybrid Aviator. And it's getting a real pull because wealthy customers also, you know, have that conscience as well for the world. They also see the great performance figures and say, oh, I like that. But it's a two thing, you know, they get more performance and they're doing the right thing for the planet, and they just work really well, right? And that whole, I don't have to go to the gas station is huge. And in that type of customer as well. So we've started there. We've just brought that product to market. It's going very well. But electric Lincolns are for sure something we're going to do. And we would be foolish not to share the battery scale and technology, of course. So yes, that's part of our $11.5 billion.
Great. So they're really thinking big, which I like. That's what you have to do when it comes to making an electric vehicle. And speaking of making an electric vehicle, there are some major challenges here. So I wanted to hear direct from Ford, what was the biggest challenge in making the Mach-E?
The one it wasn't, because, I mean, our EPE team, electrical powertrain engineering team, they've been making electric cars for a long time. So the taxis in New York have been running at hundreds of thousands of miles, hybrids. So they've got experience. So the drivetrain and the battery system has been really good. The sign-off has been really clean. Kudos to that team. So that hasn't been the hard piece. But when we decided that the digital HMI system that we had planned was nowhere near good enough, and we just needed a whole new system, that was our greatest challenge. And we did the same, so how are we gonna approach this? So we went to see the real guys that do programming and work, and I asked them, guys, do you know what next gen HMI really looks like? And one of them pulled out his Alienware laptop, said, are you kidding me? Just come back from a gaming convention in South Korea. Here, look at that. Oh, you got it. And I said, well, how would we do that? And how would we do it in time for this car? And he said, we shut the door. We said, equal, no grade. This is how we work here. He said, well, I'm not working the way we work. I said, well, okay, well, how then? He said, well, working like a software company. The guys work in teams, in scrums, cross-functional. They've got the support they need, direct access to customers, and management get out of the way and let us do our work. So, okay, well, we want to do that. So we set that team up. They named themselves Team Menlo, because they always name themselves, right? And they worked, and we went every day. What do you need today? Coffee, pizza, some screens. Just gave them what they needed to move. And they went out and did research with customers in 2 weeks and live streamed the research to the development team. And they iterated. And then they watched what customers wanted, because customers can't just tell you what they want. You have to try things and get to know them. And so they developed an all new HMI demonstration in 90 days. And along the way, they said, your screen's too small, go and get me a bigger screen. We were like, oh, it's too late for that. And actually, I've got to say, a contact company that I met here at CES 2.5 years ago, I said, where am I going to get a screen from in short time? And I contacted them and said, you told me you want to work with us again. Can you get me a screen? 2 days, they turned up with a screen. So, and they got me our screen and helped us. They turned up with their team, and in 3 days we had it running on a rig, and that we got that into the car, and that was the biggest challenge.
I love that Darren mentioned they changed the way they worked in order to do this, because I think that is totally essential in order for them to have any chance of success when making an electric vehicle. And in fact, the interior of the Mach-E is one of my favorites of any electric car I've seen to date. So I was even more excited when Darren dove deeper into what that's going to be like and all the thought and care that went into that interior.
The key thing about the HMI in this car, human machine interface, we thought we wanted to make a next gen HMI that was really nice. What, wrong question. What we realized along the way is no, I need to make this whole thing personalized to you for your stuff and make your life easier. That's what it's really about. And so this HMI is completely new. It's written in HTML5, actually, which is amazing, which the guys worked out we can actually run in the car, but that means it's so flexible, we can change it so easily. Yep. And within an hour of using it, it will adapt to you. So the top things you do will move to the top. There's no home button, there's no back button. They are things, that is, yeah, that's the things we want to get rid of. Right. Because it's like, I want a nav, one push. I want a next track, one push. I want answer the phone, push, one push. Phone my wife, one push. Navigate to the gym, one push. That's what the system has been designed to do. You can only do that by surfacing the things you do regularly so that they're there. So it takes an hour, just use it, and then your stuff's at the top. Everything else syncs back. Yeah. And it rearranges all the time to what you use. But what we watch people, after 1 hour, you're a little bit more predictable than you think you are. Yeah, and all the stuff's at the top. It's amazing. And so, and that's linked to your profile and you, your face is up front. If your wife gets in, it switches to her and adapts to her. And then you get back in, you're back to your stuff. And so that's really key to us. And a separate screen for driver information, because that's real-time critical information. And we want to keep the center clear so that, and we're very, very clear. Our auto drive system is extremely clear, because it's complicated to switch into those modes and tell people it's hands-free. So that screen allows you to be really, really clear about that. And it monitors you while you drive, true hands-free, unlimited hands-free, and it monitors you, because human beings, their concentration goes, and in this level of systems in all cars today, you're in charge. And so it has to watch that you're in charge. So if you start looking at your phone, it was gonna warn you. And then as long as you're watching, you can keep your hands off, and in an emergency, you're ready to take over. So that's how we design the interior.
Now that was new information to me, and I'm actually really excited to try it out. All I've been able to do so far is do the test ride at the unveiling, but hopefully I'll be able to get behind the wheel of one, spend some more time with it, and give you guys a sense of really what that's like with a full review in the future, hopefully this year. But before we get to that, I'm curious what you think. Would you consider buying one of these? On paper, it's the best Tesla competition out there with a good price from a reputable automaker. So spare maybe you not liking the styling or their lack of supercharger compatibility, there really aren't any reasons to dislike this car. So seriously, would you buy one? Leave me a comment, let me know, and share this video with anyone else that's curious about this, because I found this really insightful and hopefully opens up a lot of people's eyes to the possibility of going electric, which is what I'm all about here. So thanks for watching yet again, and don't forget, when you free the data, your mind will follow. I'll see you guys back here in the next one. I hope you enjoyed that interview with Darren from Ford there. And I just really want to give a big shout out to everyone on Patreon that supports the show, because you are the ones that make this possible. Now, if you would like to be a part of the community, chat with me and the other members daily, consider joining us at patreon.com/teslanomics, and I hope to see you there.